Hello and welcome to my video. In this video, I'm going to be attempting to create Minecraft in 1 week using C++ and OpenGL. Of course, this video was greatly inspired by the Minecraft in 1 week programming challenge in Unity 3D by Shane Beck, and I thought it'd be fun to try it myself, so let's get into this. So anyways, the first day was mostly spent getting your C++ OpenGL boilerplate code out of the way. For example, a game state system, the main game loop, that sort of thing. So the first step of any OpenGL program is to get something to draw onto the window. So what I just did is created the model class, which represents a drawable OpenGL object, and now I'm creating a quad renderer to render a quad onto the window. And it's fairly easy to do. You give OpenGL some vertex positions and you tell it to draw it, and then it basically just works fine, like you can see here. So now the next step is to get some shaders to work, where shaders are little programs that run on the GPU which tell OpenGL how to process the vertices and the fragments of a scene, for example giving stuff colour. So if we run the program now, as you can see, the quad is now orange. So next step is to get the shaders to work with textures, which is very important because a Minecraft game would be very boring looking if there was no textures in the blocks. And as can be seen here, the quad now has a grass looking texture. So the next step is to make the scene look 3D, because of course Minecraft is a 3D game. This is as simple as doing some matrix magic in the vertex shader, which essentially converts the 3D vertex positions of a scene into like basically the 2D screen coordinates, which makes it appear 3D. Luckily for me, there's a library called the OpenGL Maths Library, which handles all the matrix maths for me, which made making the scene 3D fairly easy. So that's all the boilerplate out of the way, and now it's time to implement some gameplay, such as a first-person camera. And the first-person camera can be seen in action right here. And well, that's the end of day one. I started off day two by trying to work out the coordinates of a simple cube. To test if my coordinates were actually correct, I created a cube renderer to, you know, render a cube. And this is obviously needed because a Minecraft world is made out of blocks, which are cube-shaped. The end result of this can be seen here, and then it was time to implement the Minecraft game itself, starting off with the block system. Unfortunately, about halfway through I realised I still needed to do one more frameworky thing, and that was implement a Texture Atlas class, which would be able to extract basically the OpenGL texture coordinates from a Texture Atlas image. And this can be seen here. On the right there is my Texture Atlas, and on the left is, well, the game itself, where I have a different texture on each side of the cube. It was now time to actually get the chunks to draw. There are actually multiple ways to approach this problem, the most obvious of which is to just draw every single block individually using a cube renderer like I showed earlier in the video. However, that'll probably be the most stupid way to do it. What I did instead was build a chunk mesh generator, which can be seen being created in the background of this video right now. It's a fairly simple thing to do. You basically iterate through every single block in the chunk, and then check the blocks that surround it. If one of the block faces is an air block or a other transparent block, then add that block face to the mesh. However, if there's a solid opaque block there, then well, don't bother putting a block face there because that would just be wasting rendering time. So what you end up with is essentially a shell around the chunk which has the block and the block textures on it. As per usual, the first test with the mesh building didn't go very well at all, so something has to be done about this. Unfortunately, a couple of hours had passed, and I still wasn't able to get it working, so that's the end of day two. Approximately another hour of looking in the incorrect places before I realised it wasn't the mesh building that was wrong, but rather the rendering that was wrong. After changing that single line of code, it worked. So yeah, that's kind of annoying, but now it's time to continue. So now that I've got a single chunk section of an area of 16 by 16 by 16 blocks to draw, it was time to get more chunks to draw. To start off with, I created sort of a chunk column class, which represents a single column of chunks. The final result of this can be seen here, and it works just about fine. However, if I go onto the inside of the chunk, you'll see that it's also rendering, well, basically block faces on the inside of the chunk. Which is not ideal, because you wouldn't normally be able to see these, so something had to be done about that. This involves basically looking at the surrounding chunks and seeing if there's a solid block there. It's meant to be a fairly simple problem to solve, but I made a silly logic error and it ended up taking over an hour, unfortunately. So here's my chunk, and if I go on the inside, there's nothing to see, which means it worked perfectly. So now that I was getting face culling to work inside of the chunks, I was going to see if it worked with a field of grass. So that's what I'm going to try and do now. Generating an area of 16 by 16 chunks, and then drawing them. That number of chunks takes a little while to generate, seeing as I'm doing it all on the main thread for now, but when it finally generates, you can see that it works just about fine. So now that I had world generation working, I just sort of played around for about 10 minutes. However, it was now time to get the game to actually look like Minecraft. For example, making the top layer grass, the bottom three layers dirt, and then the rest stone. To finish off D3, I wanted to get block editing to work. I did this by making a raycast. Essentially, it sends out the ray from the player's current position, and when it hits a block, if the player is pressing the left mouse button, it breaks that block. However, when a block changes in a chunk, that means regenerating the section's mesh where the block was, well, changed. Once again, problems will arise when it comes to chunk edges. Because as you can see here, when I break these blocks and I reach the edge of the chunk, then the other chunk's block faces don't actually get updated. Luckily, this is a fairly easy fix. However, that is now the end of D3. To begin D4, I attempted to create a skybox. To do this, I used an OpenGL feature known as a cube texture map, which is a texture in the shape of a cube. In other words, it's perfect for skyboxes. The first test didn't exactly go great because you could clearly see the edges of the skybox. And to make matters worse, you could literally fly to the edge and go outside of it, which clearly isn't really meant to happen. In an attempt to fix this, I simply made it so that, well, the cube of the skybox didn't get moved by the view matrix of the camera. This sort of worked, except it had one big issue. The skybox was static now. This is because getting rid of the view matrix multiplication also got rid of the view matrices rotation, which means the sky was not rotating. So to fix this, I re-added the view matrix once again. But to prevent flying to the edge of the skybox, I reset the view matrix translation. This means that the skybox will only be affected by the camera's rotation. And, well, the result of the finished skybox can be seen here. And, well, it works exactly as expected. The next thing that I wanted to do was make it so the world was able to generate while the player was playing the game, because, well, waiting for the world to load is not very fun at all. So, to do this, I made it so that exactly one chunk mesh was generated per frame. Another option would be multi-threading, but that's a bit complicated for now. The problem with the way that I'm doing it is that the speed at which the world generates is sort of locked to the frame rate of the game, and also means that the frame rate is lowered by the world generation. But, well, for now it works perfectly fine, so I'm not really too bothered about that. The final thing that I wanted to do today was make it so the world generation is actually somewhat interesting. So to achieve this, I used a noise algorithm. Now, honestly, I don't really know how noise works, but, well, I just know how to use it. So anyways, using noise, I generate a height map, and then I fill in the chunk's blocks using the height map. The basic algorithm for this can be seen here. Like, for now it's quite messy, so I'll probably clean this up tomorrow, but for now it works just fine. I also decided to add trees, and the end result of this can be seen here. Obviously, some of the trees are looking a bit strange thanks to chunk edges being very annoying. But I can fix this tomorrow, and that's the end of D4. To start off D5, I was basically cleaning a lot of the chunk code. I also added a crosshair so I could see more easier which block the player is looking at. Anyways, after cleaning the code for a little bit, I decided to try and add an event system. Essentially, this means sending events to an event handler, and then the event handler sort of handling the events. The first event of which I added was the player dig event, and this is the event that is called when the player either places or removes a block. After doing that, I decided to try and make the world infinite. It's fairly simple to do. Rather than checking chunks in a fixed area, you check them around the player. The first test wasn't exactly very impressive, but you can see how the chunks are trying to generate around the player. However, I felt like I didn't really need this, so I simply went back to the fixed size mode and removed the infinite terrain. After this, I decided to try and add a collision detection system, but unfortunately the clip went missing. Regardless of those unfortunate events, the collision detection system can be seen in action right here. Of course, the jumping is a little bit strange, but, well, it works, so that's the important thing. I then wanted to try add something that I've never actually tried before, and that thing is an item system. So the plan was that when you break a block, it would add that block into the player's inventory, and when you place a block, it would remove the item. So to do this, I created multiple classes. The first class was Material, which essentially holds data about holdable materials. The second class was Item Stack, which essentially holds information about how many items are in a stack. And the player sort of holds an array of these item stack objects, and then the player dig event sort of handles how the blocks are removed and added into the player's inventory. Now honestly, my implementation probably wasn't perfect, but to be fair, it was my first time doing something like this, so I felt like I did an okay job. And this can be seen in action right here. For now, I just displayed the inventory as plain text on the left there. As you can see, the player's inventory is currently empty. But when I go to break some grass blocks, they get added into the player's inventory. Furthermore, when I go to break some dirt blocks, they get added into a different item stack. And well, the same applies to when I break some logs. Also, when I go to place the blocks, you can see the numbers going down, and when it reaches zero, the item gets reset back into, well, nothing. So yeah, that means it works fine. And you probably notice how I'm not actually using the collision detection anymore, and that's because it sort of just stopped working. But I can fix that, and well, that's the end of day 5. So to start off day 6, I did some very basic optimization, starting off with a chunk mesh building. You see, before I was leaping through every single block, when you don't exactly need to do this, and about 90% of the chunk column is completely underground and occluded by other solid blocks. In other words, those blocks would have no chance of getting their block faces added into the chunk. So basically, I split the chunk into layers and I counted how many opaque blocks were on each layer. Essentially, before looping through a layer in the chunk mesh building, you can check the adjacent layers to see if there's any translucent blocks. And if there are any translucent blocks, then you can loop through it to build the mesh. However, if it's all opaque, then there's no point looping through it. In the console though, I'm printing out how long it takes to build a mesh. Here you can see it with the optimizations turned off, where it's taking multiple milliseconds to build a chunk, which is not good. And then with the optimizations turned on, you can see it's taking a fraction of a millisecond, unless it's one of the top chunks. Another optimization I did was frustum culling, which can be seen in very exaggerated effect right here. Essentially, this means just drawing the chunks in the camera's view, which just saves a lot of rendering time really. With the optimizations in play, I thought it'd be appropriate to try and get rid of the non-fixed size world and re-add the sort of infinite world. And while doing this, I also wanted to improve how the world generates in a sort of circle around the player rather than just in lines. This can be seen here. When I open up the game, the world loads in a circle around the player. And when I fly around, the world loads in. And if I turn around, you can see the world getting deleted. And then it just continues to load in a circle around the player. And just to prove it actually is infinite, you can see some sped up footage right here. But looking at this, the world is very boring. It's basically just an infinite forest. And so it was time to completely redo the world generation and add some biomes. To create biomes, a noise generator can be used, where different ranges of numbers apply to different biomes. And well, this can be seen here, where the biome map was created using some very basic noise. This was the first test, where I spawned right into a desert with some grasslands in the background there. Of course, for now there's no trees for the sake of the rewrite. For now, this is all good and all, where a different biome means a different surface block, but it's a bit boring really. Wouldn't it be better if different biomes had different, like, height map generation? And well, that's exactly what I did next. Of course, the trees have no leaves, but that's not the important thing here. The different biomes now actually do have different height map generations, but obviously the border between them is a very sharp and harsh sheer cliff basically. And this is very expected because you can't exactly expect a very nice natural transition between different noise generation functions. Luckily, this is a fairly easy fix. This problem can be solved using something called bilinear interpolation. So what I did is essentially work out the heights that say every 4 blocks like you can see here. And let's just say we want to find the value at the question marks there, where x equals 2 and z equals 2 in the function arguments. The function here does some magic, and then it pops out a value. And then you can do this for every single block, and then you end up with a fairly smooth transition. And this is how it looks. You can see that between the biomes there are now there's somewhat a transition between them, and well, that looks a lot better than sheer cliffs like before. However, that is the end of day 6 now, and there's just one more day to go. I spent the final day making the game just look a bit better. To start off with, I added an ocean biome, and then I added directional lighting for the blocks. This is basically where different block faces have different light values depending on their direction. For example, the top of the blocks will have the most light, the side will have slightly less light, and then the bottom will have the least light. The directional lighting can be seen here, and hopefully, as you can see, it's a huge improvement over before. And just for comparison's sake, here's a short before video. The next thing I wanted to do was improve what the trees look like, because right now they're practically lollipops. And then I also added palm tree generation for the ocean biomes. And the new trees and the palm trees can be seen here. A while back, you may have noticed I added water, but right now it just looks like a solid block, so I wanted to make it look translucent. To achieve this, I actually had to render the water separately from the solid blocks, otherwise, well, OpenGL gets all confused with the rendering order and it ends up looking really strange. The only downside to this is it means it requires two draw calls per chunk if there's water there. But, you know, I think it's definitely worth it, because this looks a lot better than it did before. The final touches I wanted to do to beautify the world was to add some small plants. Of course, this means adding some more blocks, but it also means changing how the mesh building works a little bit. See, usually blocks have a cube-shaped mesh, but plants are not cube-shaped, they're more of an X-shaped mesh. This simply means using some different OpenGL coordinates when a plant is about to be added to a chunk's mesh. Plants are then added into the world using the terrain generation, depending on which biome they're in. The most common plant types are the rose and the tall grass, but in the desert you will also find dead shrubs. However, if you look at the FPS now, it's pretty embarrassing, and this is because everything is still being done on a single thread, the rendering and the world loading. So the final thing to do today is to simply put them on different threads, and then it will improve the FPS hopefully. So the first test can be seen here, and as you can see, the FPS has been improved by a huge amount. But unfortunately, the whole world is black, but luckily I know why. The OpenGL typically only actually works on one thread, so if you call OpenGL functions from two separate threads, then you're going to go to Funky Town like you can see here. What I was doing was creating an OpenGL texture object on the thread that isn't the rendering thread, and thus it was all black. However, if I fix that and put it on the correct thread, it now works fine. And then you get the textured world and the very improved FPS. And well, that marks the end of the final day. So that is it, that's the end of 7 days of creating Minecraft using C++ and OpenGL. While it may not be the most beautiful or the most featureful version of Minecraft in the world, there of course is only so much you can actually do in 7 days. So anyways, I hope you enjoyed the video. A link to the source code as well as a download link for the game itself will both be found in the description below. And please comment below what you want to see next. And anyway, once again, thank you for watching and goodbye.